Okay, so that is the third movement of the Stravinsky Three Pieces, one of the most important and fantastic solo clarinet pieces in our repertoire. Now, if you don't know this piece, you've got to get to know this piece. And you know, the thing that's kind of cool about it is that if you're an intermediate player, you can still play the first movement of this piece. It's not that difficult, and it starts to kind of get you into the flavor of what playing Stravinsky is like. We're not going to talk about that movement or the second movement today. We're going to talk about the third movement because there is a really interesting story. That story influences how I, and I would argue maybe you, could approach this last piece of the three. So here's the story. Back in 1918, Stravinsky was looking for someone to underwrite, to pay for and fund his chamber drama work, L'Histoire du Soldat, The Soldier's Tale. It's for a chamber ensemble and three actors. And this guy, Werner Reinhardt from Switzerland, decided that he would go ahead and pay for this. And he went ahead and funded the piece, and he paid for this tour afterwards. And as a thank you, Stravinsky decided to dedicate the three pieces for Werner Reinhardt, who I think was probably an amateur clarinetist, I believe. Anyway, around the same time, Stravinsky and the Swiss conductor, Ernest Ansermet, are like best buddies. Ansermet is conducting Ballet Russe up in London, conducting The Firebird or The Rite of Spring, one of Stravinsky's really big pieces. And after a show, Ansermet goes out to a club and he encounters for the first time jazz music. And he hears specifically Sidney Bechet playing the clarinet. And it blows his freaking mind. He gets on the phone to Stravinsky and he's like, yo, Igor, check it out. I was just at this club and I just heard this guy named Sidney Bechet, I think was his name. He was playing stuff called jazz. It's from America. You gotta check this out. It's the most amazing thing. And Stravinsky's like, ho, slow down. Ernest, whoa. Dude, shh. Okay, I'll check it out. Now, here comes this piece of music. This piece was also written around that same time, 1918, the end of 1918, the three pieces. And I would argue, though it's questionable whether Stravinsky heard jazz first or didn't, I would have to argue that Stravinsky at least saw sheet music for jazz. And it's very probable to me that he also heard jazz. And I think in specific, he heard Sidney Bechet play. Why? Well, I'll play you why. Because there is so much in common between the third movement of these three pieces and Sidney Bechet's improvisation that it seems to me really unlikely that Stravinsky wasn't influenced by that. So, and the reason that I'm talking about this, it completely changed the way that I approach this third movement of the three pieces. It used to be a piece of new music to me. It is now a piece of jazz written by Stravinsky. And Stravinsky then went on to have a long relationship with jazz. So let's listen to Sidney Bechet and let's see how these things sort of work together and see where in this third piece there are some idiomatic jazz moments that Stravinsky ripped off. Let me quickly set this up for you. You are Igor Stravinsky, a world-famous composer. Your buddy Ernest has got a record in his hand of Sidney Bechet's Characteristic Blues, which I have read, so therefore it is true, was the first piece of jazz Stravinsky ever heard. Now, the first part of this piece of music, it's slower and it doesn't really relate to this topic right now. It's interesting, you should go check it out on Spotify. But the end, the last 45 seconds of this piece, we start to hear the beginnings of what Stravinsky might have incorporated in this last of the third pieces. And what I want you to listen for is some triplet action that Sidney Bechet plays, which is... He does that a lot, which is reminiscent, for me, of this line. And it comes back a couple times in the third of the three pieces. And you might hear something, if I were to change this slightly, it sounds an awful lot like what you're going to hear. Okay, so that's one thing I want you to listen for. And the second thing I want you to listen for is the amount of repetition that Bechet uses where he changes just one note. So I'll give you an example from the Stravinsky. Just changes one note. Okay, so I'm playing this out of style just to make it sound a little bit more like what you're going to listen to. Here, let's listen to it. That repetition with one note. Thank you. So that is the characteristic blues. The second piece that I want to play for you, which is around the same time, Sidney Bechet started learning the soprano saxophone, I'm told, in London in like 1917 or so. So Sidney Bechet has gotten pretty good at soprano saxophone. He starts recording on soprano sax. And this piece, Limehouse Blues, is another piece which I think also bears a lot of resemblance to this third of the three pieces. Why do you think Stravinsky is into this at this particular point in his career? Well, let's think about the pieces that Stravinsky has been writing. He's been writing The Rite of Spring. He's written L'Histoire du Soldat. He's writing this piece of music. There's a lot of angularity and a lot of syncopation and a lot of rhythm. And here is Sidney Bechet doing the exact same thing in popular culture. It is a perfect union of the two of these, I would argue, in this third of the three Stravinsky pieces for clarinet. So let me play the beginning of Limehouse Blues. I want you to listen again for the syncopation, the triplet moves, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. He does that again in here. And just sort of listen to the general aesthetic of what Bechet is playing. Stravinsky listened to. But let's talk about a few circumstantial bits of evidence here. We have what this sounds like. We have the fact that the soprano saxophone only comes in B flat, all right? They don't make an A soprano sax. The first two movements of this piece are in A. This movement's in B flat. I don't know if there's any relationship to that, but it's something that's interesting to me and possibly relevant, okay? We've got the fact that all of the rhythmic things. Okay, as an experiment, what I'm going to do is I'm going to play the end of this movement with the end of Limehouse Blues in the style of Sidney Bechet, you know, in a kind of ragtime stomp. Now what that means is I'm going to have to change a little bit of the rhythm of this to line up with that, but what I'd like you to check out is that stylistically, it kind of works. Now, this is a lot faster than you would ever play this movement, and the end of it is almost impossible to play at this tempo, so just, you know, be nice. But anyway, let's give it a shot, see what you think. I'm sold. Now, I know for a lot of people, this is sacrilegious. This is heresy. Because, you know, many of us were taught by some of the best teachers of our generation that this is a piece of classical music. I am here to argue that it is a piece of jazz music. Whether or not Stravinsky heard this before he wrote it, it was all happening in the same zeitgeist of 1917, 1918, 1919. This is what was happening in culture, and Stravinsky, like it or not, is a part of that culture, even though he is on the classical side of it. So what I would argue is try it. Listen to this as a piece of jazz. Try to play it with a little bit more freedom. Not rhythmic freedom, don't change too much about the rhythm, but stylistically play it like a piece of jazz. I bet you will dig it. I know audiences love it. But if you want to argue about it, let's take it to the comments section. I would love a good discussion about this piece. So, now I would like to say thank you for watching this season. I will be back in August. I'm going to take the summer off. I want you all to go practice. I want you all to have a great time. I want you to remember to take some time off of the clarinet. It's always good to take a break from the horn. And we'll be back in August to talk about some more stuff. Until then, have a great summer. Bye.